the same concepts, the same calculations kind of going through. But I want to at least talk through the first few and tell you why I assigned them and the concepts that you're seeing and then the calculations that you might need to be aware of because of those concepts. So the first one, number one, is net present value. And it's very straightforward, and I told you guys, don't get used to the ones that had the even cash flows. So again, when I gave you the discussion board, please take home number four. I made sure I didn't give you even cash flows so that you guys can see what that looks like. But basically what's new, you guys are used to getting into the cash flow mode of your calculator, hitting CF. You guys are used to hitting the inputs then to calculate a net present value. The only thing that's new for this chapter is that at time period zero, you have a cash flow. Your time period zero cash flow will always be a negative because that is when you are buying a project. Because remember, chapter 13, we're looking at what it's like for companies to buy projects. So your cash flow zero will always be a negative, and that is the plus minus key that is the same color as your numbers. So all you're having to do is you're having to tell it, okay, I've got a negative cash flow of $1,000 at time period zero. Then I've got my cash flows along the way. So the first cash flow of time period one is cash flow one. There's one of them. Then the 480 at time period two is cash flow two. There's one of them, and so on. So you're basically just setting up the timeline for your calculator. So that's nothing new. Then, after I get all those cash flows in, I hit my net present value button, which is right next to my cash flow button, and it asks me for my I. And I is the required rate of return between the cash flows. And they're telling you that the cost of capital, so that's going back to chapter 11, your weighted average cost of capital, or your required rate of return then, to invest in this project is 8%. So your I is 8. Enter down arrow, and I'm not putting enter down arrow on all these because, you know, you guys are kind of used to that by now. But anytime you're in that cash flow mode, you have to enter down arrow for your numbers to stick. Remember, when you see net present value, you have to hit CPT to get it to calculate. So this project has a positive net present value of $657.47. Since it's greater than or equal to zero, then it's an acceptable project. And on the take-home discussion board, as well as on the exam, you'll have to do your accept and reject decisions. Any questions or concerns on number one? Pretty straightforward. Number two, the reason I assigned that one is because when you put in the numbers, it's pretty much the same. Time period zero, you've got a negative 8,000. Then you've got the cash flows. Watching your timeline, you've only got four cash flows. So after you get those into your calculator, continue to arrow down. If you've still got a cash flow number five setting in there, you've got to zero it out. So a zero cash flow at time period five if you've got everything in there. One way that you can clear that cash flow mode of your calculator is if you hit that CF button and then you hit the CPT clear work, that should clear it. Oh, wait, no, second clear work, sorry. I wonder why that didn't work. So hit your cash flow button, hit your second button, and then hit the CEC, which is your clear work. So CF, second, CE slash C button. And I would recommend that you do that just so that there isn't some fifth or sixth cash flow out there that you forget about on an exam. Or if you start getting too many zeros stored in there, you'll get an iteration error. It won't want to calculate your internal rate of return because it doesn't understand what you're really trying to tell it. It's searching for more cash flows. So you get this negative 8,000, you get your timeline input, each of them just has a frequency of one. When you hit your net present value button, it asks for the I, that's 12%, 12 enter down arrow. When you get to the net present value, you hit CPT and it's a negative 404.10. That's why I assigned to reject the project. I wanted you to see one where you reject it. Questions on one or two? Changing gears a little, we go to problem number five. Remember, we're going to set this one up because it's a payback period, so we're going to set it up like it's a little checkbook that we're keeping just for the project. Since it's payback period, there's no time value of money, so we're just looking at the cash flows that we get. So we're just taking our timeline, we're setting that up, so we've got time period 0 through 5 that I have in the left-hand column. I've got the cash flows that they give me in my middle column, my cash flow column. And then in my cumulative column, that's where I'm kind of keeping a little running total of what this project is doing for me. So start out time period 0, I invest $11,000, so that's a negative. Then a year later, I deposit $3,350, so I'm still negative $7,650. And then every year, that's what I'm doing. I'm just keeping that running total. Year 4, nothing happens, so the negative 1950 carries down. So year 4, it stays negative 1950. So then year 5, I get 1,000. It's still negative $950. The reason I like to show you guys this one is because if it ends up that you get a problem and it's a negative at the end of the time periods that you're given, don't try to add more time to it. I don't know, on exams, that's what I've had students do, where they start making up new time periods, like they add year 6 for another $1,000 or something. I guess they just feel like it has to break even somehow. All they're telling you is, during the 5 years that you have this project, with the cash flows that you would be getting, you never break even. You never get your money back. So there's no way for you to show me the years, the partial years, so you just have to reject it. You never get your money back. This type of a situation would be the only time that you don't have to calculate your year and your partial year for me. I don't care how obvious it is. If I give you something that pays back in 3 years, but yet it has a 5-year hurdle rate, and you get to it and you can see that it's going to be less than the 5 years, you still need to calculate your full and partial years for me, because that's part of you showing me your concepts as well as your calculations. So don't just eyeball it and give me an answer and move on. You won't get full credit, even if you guessed it right. And that's why I show you number 6. Because in number 6, it becomes very evident, because what's happening here is they're saying that they want you to compute then the payback period. They want you to figure out if you can accept or reject it. And what they're saying, they give you the 8% capital, but you're really not going to use that because it's just your simple payback period. But they say that it has to pay back in 4 years, okay, so 4 years or less. So when you do the calculation for number 6, year 3, you're positive. You're positive to 350, so it's quite obvious that you paid back before the 4 years. But I'm saying if you did this on an exam, and you get to where you see in year 3, you're already positive, so of course it pays back in less than 4 years. I still want you to go and show me that you know that year 2 was the last year you had a negative, so you pulled that for your whole number. You still had $170,000 left to recover, so that's the numerator of your partial year. You broke even in a $420 year, excuse me, $520 year, so 520 is your denominator. So I want you to show me that you can calculate the 2.33 years. Don't just look at your column and say, I see it, so I don't have to show you the 2.33 years. You'll lose points. Uh-huh. On the exam, if you wanted to stop at year 3, that's fine. You don't have to continue to calculate on down. I know this is going to be a longer exam, and truly, once you break even, you're done. So once you get your positive in your cumulative column, you can stop your calculations. It'll save you some time. But you still have to show me the 2.33 years, even though it's quite evident that it was less than 4 years. Then in number seven, what I did in number seven, since it's a discounted payback period, I decided I would show you guys what I'm doing then to get my discounted cash flow column. You're going to have to show me your work somewhere on the exam so that I know what's going on in case you make a mistake. So with discounted payback period, what I'm doing then is I'm showing the time column, I'm showing the cash flow column, but then I'm showing my discounted cash flow column. So to answer your question, you can see I stopped once I got to where I saw positive in my cumulative column. But what I'm doing then is I'm just showing you, okay, how did I get the 444.44? Well, I said one end, IY at 8, future value being the 480, zero payment, bringing these cash flows back to present value. Because remember, with discounted payback period, I have to bring each of the cash flows back to its own present value. So if you make a mistake with your end, or you make a mistake with future value versus present value, or if you call something a payment, I'm not going to know to give you partial credit unless you show me your work. Okay? So you won't get full or partial credit without showing me your work on those. So then for number two, the way I got the second time period, the 480, the way I got the 411.52 was I was two periods out with an IY of 8, future value 480, payment 0, and I calculate the present value. So if you just wanted to even make me a little chart, I mean, I'm basically just showing the end, the IY, the future value, the payment, and the present value. It goes really fast. It's really fast to document your work that way. So then remember with discounted payback period, what's happening is the time period zero cash flow, a dollar is worth a dollar, so that stays the negative thousand that I'm investing. Then I'm using the discounted cash flow column to get my cumulative column. So it's the 1,000 netted with the 444.44 to get the 555.56 that I'm still negative. Then I net that with the 411.52. I'm still negative 144.04. Net that with the 412.79 from time period 3. And I finally turn positive. So I know that year two is the last year that I have a negative in my cumulative column, so that's my whole number. And now watch, because here's where people start making mistakes. Once again, bring this negative 144.04 in its absolute value. So don't make it be a minus, it has to be a positive. Then you're going to use the cash flow the year you break even, but what's different here compared to the payback period is in discounted payback period, you're using the time value of money. So I'm using the 412.79 instead of the 520. So I'm 2.35 years into this project before I get my money back. The hurdle rate for this one was 3 years so I can accept the project. Questions or comments on discounted payback period? I actually threw one of those on the little take-home in lieu of your discussion boards because discounted payback and modified internal rate of return are where people make the most mistakes. So I threw those two on what you need to take home for more practice. The only reason I threw problem 8 on here, it's another discounted payback period. I liked it because it showed you how to deal with a zero cash flow, and I also liked it because you never broke even, so it showed you that you need to just stop. So if you got one where you never broke even, using discounted payback, you just stop and move on. You have to reject it. Questions or comments on 7 or 8 or discounted payback period in general? Number 9 is an internal rate of return. I don't know why they just didn't give that to you when they were presenting. Number one, they just changed one number on you. They could have just let you calculate the internal rate of return at number one, but that's okay. So what they're telling you here is they want you to use the timeline and they want you to go back to your uneven cash flow mode of your calculator and get those cash flows input. So your cash flow zero is a negative 1,000, then you've got one cash flow for each of the next ones. You're just setting up the timeline. The difference is now after you hit cash flow and get all of those in, again, remember your up and down arrow key you can use to re-look at your timeline, make sure that you don't have anything else sitting in there. Up and down arrow keys don't change anything unless you hit enter. So after you get everything in your cash flows, all you have to do is hit the IRR button because you want internal rate of return. But if you notice, I remind you, you've got to hit CPT because once you hit IRR, it's going to display zero if you've cleared your calculator or the last internal rate of return that was stored. So don't give me a homework answer or a review sheet answer or a take-home quiz answer because you forget to get an internal rate of return. So get your CPT, so 25.49%. Remember, for accepting and rejecting internal rate of return, it has to be greater than the required rate of return. They're saying that this one has a cost of capital of 8%. Since 25.49 is greater than or equal to 8%, you can accept this project. Questions or comments on number 9? Hopefully net present value and internal rate of return are just easy points on the exam for you guys. I showed you number 10 for a reason, because again, it's internal rate of return. You're just inputting the numbers into your timeline, but what I liked about it is the answer comes out 0.21%. So you don't convert that to a percentage. That already is a percentage. It's not that you need to make it be 21%. Whatever you get with your IRR answer is already in a percentage. So it's a 0.21%. And I like it that I get to show you that with this problem. So 0.21% compared to the 12% required rate of return, you reject this. If you accidentally tried to convert that, not realizing that it was already a percent, you would erroneously accept this project. So that would be a concept there. So that's why I like that one. Questions or comments on those two internal rates of return? Chapter 11 real quick. So chapter 11, what we were determining was the cost of our debt and equity holders. Okay, so our weighted average cost of debt and equity holders. So then what internal rate of return is doing is it's plotting what you would be investing at time period zero against those future cash flows. So it's giving you a look, given the time value of money, what your rate of return is for those. Okay, so if you look at your internal rate of return, so that means internal to this one project is basically what that means. So this one project's rate of return is, in this case, the 0.21%.
Okay, and it's in that return is paying back.
Right.
Okay.
What you would get for a rate of return for that one project only. So good question. Which is different, okay, so that's kind of a good lead-in, though, because looking at 11, so this is a good time for me to explain the difference. In number 11, what's happening is it's having you treat every cash flow that you get from a project as if you're going to go and take that cash flow at the end of the year and invest it at your required rate of return. So internal rate of return isn't really taking into account what the company could do as they get the money back. Modified internal rate of return is taking into account for like a growth company what it would be like if they take the money and reinvest in their own company. So in modified internal rate of return, what you're saying is, let's pretend like we have a growth company. Let's pretend like like every time we get some cash back from our investments, we reinvest it in our own company. And so then the concept there is that when we reinvest in our own company, we're going to use our cost of capital. We're going to use the minimum then that we would require for the evaluation. So in number 11, with modified internal rate of return, they tell you that your cost of capital is 12%. So for your step one, you're going to take each of the cash flows that you're seeing on page 470, and you're going to pretend like you're reinvesting those. So the $5,330 at time period one, well, this is a four-year project, and I showed you this on the homework. So my N is going to be the four-year project minus the fact that I'm getting this cash flow at time period one. So I've got 3 years that I can invest that money. I'm going to invest it at my required rate of return, my cost of capital of 12%. And I think it's really easy for students to see this when we're just doing a problem and you don't see anything else about this project. But what happens on the exam is I think people see internal rate of return right above where they're calculating modified internal rate of return. And for some reason, they think that they need to grab that. You're not saying that you're reinvesting at this project's internal rate of return. You're saying you're investing at your company's required rate of return, your weighted average cost of capital. So I'm reinvesting at my cost of capital. I'm going to treat all of the cash flows like a present value, so exactly opposite of discounted payback period, where they were a future value. So now instead of having future value to present value, it's just the opposite. It's present value to future value. And again, people get these two mixed up with what they need to do. So the concept is I'm going to pretend like I'm going to take this $5,330 and grow it to its future value because I'm going to invest it during those 3 years that are left in the project. So the concept is there, and that helps support your calculation. So if you understand the concept of what you're doing, it'll help you understand what calculation you need to do. So in modified internal rate of return, as I get the cash flows, I'm investing them in my own company. So payment is zero. Calculate future value. Then the $4,180 that I get at time period two, well, time period two, it's a four-year project. I'm at time period two, so there's 2 years left. I'm investing the $4,180 at 12%, payment zero, calculate future value. The cash flow at time period three, the $1,520, four-year project, I get this at time period three, there's 1 period left, still my 12%, present value is the cash flow that I see setting there, no payment, calculate future value. And then finally, at year four, when I get that $2,000, it's a four-year project, I'm getting it at the end of year four, so there's no time left. It's like I'm going to go to the bank, give them this $2,000, and immediately ask them what's sitting in this account from this project. So you wouldn't even have to show me this last step, that $2,000 present value equals $2,000 future value, but I'm putting it on there just so that you guys know, don't forget that one, when you're adding all of those future values up. Okay, so step one of modified internal rate of return ends with you adding all the future values that you calculate from the cash flows on the timeline up. Remember, put in your notes, step one does not include your time period zero cash flow. We don't consider the time period zero cash flow until step two. And if you think about it, you can't invest negative cash flow. If you're writing a check today to buy a piece of machinery, you're not investing that money in the bank. You're not putting it somewhere else to earn money. You're writing a check. So step two is when you take into account your time period zero cash flow as your present value. The future value that you calculate in step one is your future value for step two. So if you make any mistakes, I'll flow it through. It's a four-year project. Payment is zero. The goal here then for step two is to compute your IY. And I don't know why, but for some reason, students try to force an IY of a required rate of return. That's not what's happening. In internal rate of return and modified internal rate of return, you're calculating the IY. That's the final goal. Calculate the return for that project. Calculate the IY for that project. So that's how step two ends, calculating the IY. Then we're looking, our cost of capital was 12%. This is only going to have a modified internal rate of return of 10.56, so we would have to reject this project. Number 12, I shouldn't have put on here because we've got negative cash flow, so skip number 12. And I told you that in the lecture in case I forgot to take some off. So skip number 12. And then we just kind of get back into another payback period on number 17. And honestly, what I did, 17 through 21 and 23 through 27, is just you going through one timeline and using all the five methods that I want you to do. So it's just more practice. So there's really no new concepts to start to stick out, nothing where there's anything that you probably really need to talk about. So as you were going through 17 through 21 or 23 through 27, did you guys have any questions, comments? So the question was, will I post a breakdown for the exam? As soon as I get it written, I will. Okay, so that'll probably be on, I will have it done by review day, maybe even optional review day. I'll get that to you. All problems. So before you leave today, make sure that you get one of each of these take-home quiz things that we have those master discussion boards. And if you want to start the review sheet, it is out there on Black.